立法會主席。
The President。
請各位。
Members will please remain standing while the Chief Executive enters the chamber.When the Chief Executive enters the chamber, the request to speak system will start immediately. Members who wish to ask questions may press the button to indicate their wish.
Liang Guohong,
Mr. Liang Guohong.Please put down your placard. Your placard is blocking my view. Please put it down. The Chief Executive will first address the Council. Dr. Ching Chung Tai, I think Mr. Holden Chow is against the rules of procedure.By being here, he has to show us that he is not acting in collusion with the Chief Executive. Please, now sit down. Chief Executive, President, members, fellow citizens, over the past 5 years, we have achieved progress in different areas, the economy, infrastructural development, livelihood improvement, deepening of internal and external ties, and so on.Economically, inflation and joblessness remain very low. People's earnings have increased and the business environment is largely good. The government is financially robust. Hong Kong's competitiveness and economic freedom top the world. This administration holds fast to the idea of appropriately proactive. We have been developing traditional industries.Finance, trade, tourism, shipping, logistics, professional service, and move them towards high value added and diversified developments. We've also nurtured emerging industries. We have set up the IT Bureau, devoting $18 billion to take forward innovation and technology to broaden the economic base and provide for the younger generation a broader range of better paid jobs and startup opportunities.In order to further enhance Hong Kong's competitiveness, this administration has taken forward a number of transport and cultural infrastructure projects, and they are nearing completion. We are developing 7 new rail lines and other large-scale road projects. Through the Hong Kong 2030 Plus, we have a territory-wide development strategy. We are planning the development and conservation of Lantau.And provide more convenient, more comfortable, and safer environment for the people of Hong Kong. On housing, which is dear to members' heart, this administration tackles not just the symptoms, but also the problem at source. We have boosted land and housing supply and launched demand management measures. In terms of supply, the land sale program for the last 5 years enabled us to.Built 51,000 private residential units, or 2.5 times more than the previous 5 financial years. The commercial and business sites measured 958,000 square meters, or 2.6 times more than the previous 5 financial years. In Hong Kong, the production cycle needs 4 to 5 years, and therefore the increase in publicand private housing will become apparent this year. In the coming 3 to 4 years, the private residential units in the primary market will reach 96,000 units, or 48% more than the beginning of this administration. Public housing for the 5 years from 2016-17, the production volume will reach 94,600.Or 42% more than the 66,800 when the administration began. We should look at supply and demand. in an objective, dispassionate, and scientific manner. Even discounting the implications of interest rate hike on prices, the 48% increase is the factor that should be considered when we look at the property prices. Over the past couple of years, the government has been giving priority to local people. We have launched a number of demand-side management measures to combat speculative external and investment demands. At the moment, short-term sale and sales involving non-local and non-local companies take up only a small percentage of the total number of transactions. For transactions involving Hong Kong permanent residents, the majority of them do not own any other residential properties in Hong Kong. In the short and medium term, through rezoning and increase in plot ratio, we can provide more than 38,000 residential units. For the medium and long term, the new development areas and new towns, including Kwu Tung North, Fanning North, NDAs, Tung Chung New Town Extension, Hong Shui Kiu NDA, and Yunong South development, coupled with the developments atop railways, this will provide 22,000 residential units or 8.6 million square meters of commercial floor space. This administration is determined in tackling poverty, elderly problems, and the disadvantaged problems. In this financial year, the recurring expenditure for social welfare reached $73.3 billion, or 71% higher than when we took office. Through the LIFA, the OALA, and other measures, we are helping the working poor, the low-income families, the senior citizens, the disabled, and other underprivileged people. For the very first time, we have formulated the poverty line to help us assess the extent of poverty and gauge the effectiveness of poverty measures. The poor population has been hovering below 1 million for 3 years, and the CSSA cases have also hit new low for 15 years. CSSA for unemployment has also dropped for 92 months or new low for 20 years. In this financial year, the recurring expenditure for education reaches $78.6 billion, or 30% more than at the beginning of this administration. In a couple of months, most of the parents would be able to benefit from the free quality kindergarten education. This administration has also been proactively developing STEM education. We have increased subsidy admission rate for post-secondary courses, and more young people will be able to enjoy overseas attachments. In this financial year, the healthcare takes up healthcare recurring expenditure is $61.9 billion, or 34% more than when the administration began. We have devoted $200 billion for the 10-year hospital development plan, and we're making preparation for the ever-increasing needs of the elderly. We have also tackled air pollution. We have scrapped 52,000 pre-Euro 4 diesel commercial vehicles. For 5 years, Hong Kong's air quality has registered noticeable improvement. The pollutants in the air have also decreased by 30%. Harbour Area Treatment Scheme 2A has already started. The water quality has also improved further. We are taking one big step closer to restoring blue skies and clear water. Law and order is an important aspect of the quality of life. This administration makes special effort in law enforcement. Through the effort of the police and the enforcement agencies, the crime statistics in 2016 are the lowest in 39 years. We have seen a decline in many serious crimes. Externally, Hong Kong needs to foster extensive, closer, and deeper ties with the mainland and outside world. We are expanding and enhancing the CEPA arrangement. We have set up 7 new ETOs. We've also set up 8 new liaison points under the mainland offices. We're also liaising and negotiating with various economies, the FTA, the Free Trade Agreement, and also Investment Promotion and Protection Agreements. This year marks the 20th anniversary of Hong Kong's return to the mainland. The world politics and economic order over the past 20 years have undergone profound changes. The country is developing by leaps and bounds with rising strength and influence. The Belt and Road Initiative and the Greater Bay Area development are of enormous scale and significance, and they will provide ample opportunity for at least 2 generations of Hong Kong people. Hong Kong enjoys the advantage of one country and the convenience of 2 systems. If we can seize the opportunity to get involved, this will bring new and massive impetus for Hong Kong's economic and social development for the next 3 decades. Under one country, 2 systems, through innovation of our system and mechanism, we can facilitate interaction between Hong Kong and the mainland and foster mutual development. President, honorable members, and fellow citizens, I am attending the Q&A session here for the last time in my term. Since we took office, we would publish our work report on an annual basis and bring members of the public up to date on the achievement and the progress of work. By the end of this month, we will be publishing the 5-year work report for public scrutiny. Here, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank government officials and colleagues for their incessant hard work, LegCo members for their input, and the members of the public for their support and cooperation. World economic order is ever-changing. Experience shows that economic prosperity cannot be taken for granted. Improvement of livelihood cannot be taken for granted. And we have to cherish all these achievements that we have made. And we have to think of potential crises when times are good and seize the opportunity for the young people to have a better future. Opportunities are lying ahead. We cannot afford to be indecisive. We cannot let time just slip by. Recently, the scrutiny of government funding proposals is getting increasingly longer, and there are projects that have to do with livelihood and long-term development repeatedly stalled. The chairman of the FC, PwSC and ESC said yesterday that the committees are progressing at a slow pace. There are about a month or so before LegCo rises. I hope that members would have a public interest in mind and speed up the scrutiny process. In a month's time, the new term of administration will come in. I hope the members will come together in support of the new administration for the well-being of the 7 million of Hong Kong, so that this pearl of the orient will shine ever brighter. Thank you. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, please put down your placard. Please do not show your placard like this. Otherwise, I'll have to ask to remove it. Point of order. A question for the chief executive. Is he here in his capacity as vice chairman of the PPCC? Well, this is not point of order. He has 2 capacity. The chief executive will now answer questions. As in the past, members who wish to put questions must press the request to speak button to indicate their wish. Question raised should be as concise as possible. Members should not make arguments when putting questions. After the chief executive has answered the questions, the member may ask a short supplementary. The member concerned only needs to raise his or her hand and does not have to press the button again. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong, President, thank you. Mr. Chief Executive, in this Q&A session, this is your last appearance in your term. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you for your hard work and also the hard work of your government officials. Mr. Chief Executive, at the beginning of the term till now, you said that it is your priority to tackle housing problem. Undeniably, you have implemented many measures like Hong Kong property for Hong Kong people, the 8OS production, and many cooling measures like the increase in stamp duty and tightening the LTV ratio. And you've also identified land all over Hong Kong to build more housing. However, from the production statistics, we see that the private and public housing statistics will increase. However, the reality is that the private property prices are peaking out all the time, and the waiting list for the PRH is getting ever longer. We feel that your efforts here are not rewarded with any particular gains. So my question is, in summarizing your housing policy, what are the difficulties that you faced, and why is it that you failed to achieve what you set out to do? And for the next chief executive in the way of housing problem, what advice would you have for her?
Mr. C, President, I thank Mr. Wong Ting Kwong for his question. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, I heard that Mr. Wong asked four questions. Is that allowed in this question time? Mr. CE, you only need to answer one question. President, housing is indeed very close to the heart of all walks of life in Hong Kong. Many opinion polls showed that in the past 5 years, regardless of what so issues were going on, the greatest concern was still housing. Grassroots and as well as the upper sectors of society set their concerns. And different generations have their concerns, and this generation worried for their next generation in matters of housing. When there are external demands and speculative demands and investment demands, the mismatch between supply and demand aggravated, and therefore there were various rounds of demand-side management measures, and they were called draconian measures by the community. However, they sought to tackle the problems at source. Now, we have a multi-pronged approach. The fundamental solution is to increase supply. We must have land before we have flats, and we have planning for lands. Land is there. It's just that the land is not zoned for housing, and therefore we have to go through the necessary procedures. That takes time, and we've also wasted some in the process, because there was a lot of stalling. Even for PRH in particular, there were objections from the local community from time to time, and therefore the process took longer. Usually, if everything goes smoothly, the production cycle is about 4 to 5 years. And this administration has about 5 years. As soon as this administration started, we rezoned sites for private land. We had land sales in RCHA to start building PRH. And so basically, production would be around here. For housing, well, there are two unique characteristics. First, it cannot be imported. For other things, they can be imported when they are short in Hong Kong. Secondly, the production cycle is long. For other basic necessities, clothing, food, well, and transportation, they can be produced within a short period of time. For housing, the production cycle in here is longer because we're talking about multi-stories, and in other places, low-rises can be done in 1 or 2 years. And for us, even production, that takes 4 years. So in the past 5 years, we've been announcing to the community the potential supply in the coming 3 to 4 years. So we take a snapshot, telling everyone in Hong Kong the production projects in both the public and private sectors were in different stages of production. We have 96,000 now, close to 50% more than when this term started. Any commodity, regardless of its nature, when other factors remain the same, when there is an increase in supply of 50%, this is quite a substantial increase in two ways. First, government departments as well as all sectors in society have indeed done a lot to achieve an other 50% supply. That will also affect the demand and supply situation. For demand, I said in my remarks that perhaps interest hike cycle started, that may affect demand and supply. We are increasing it substantially, increasingly. To address Mr. Wong Tin Kwong's question, it's very simple. The current phenomenon is a lag behind phenomenon because production takes 4 to 5 years. Hard work started in the first year, well, population intake can only start this year. And what we did in the second year of our administration will bear fruits in next year. Mr. Wong Tin Kwong asked for advice for the next administration. I'm sure it has got its own strategies to address housing issue. We must increase supply. And inevitably, we have to increase land supply. There is no other way. And we have to do so by rezoning. Mr. Wong Tin Kwong, your question has been answered, so your follow-up has to be very short. Thank you. The CEO talked about land planning. Is land planning the source of our housing problem? Do we have to change our policy on planning? CEO. We have 1,100 square kilometers of land in Hong Kong, and only 7% of it is used for housing. Only 7%. The remaining land is basically not zoned for housing. So, to increase land for housing or other purposes, we must face the issue of rezoning, which are bounded by procedures. They are appropriate. Sometimes we have to conduct an EIA, we have to consult the local community, and they are right and proper. But sometimes they are subject to unreasonable tactics, including JR. Even judges have commented some JRs were unnecessary, delaying the process. So we need concerted efforts from everyone in society. I hope we can take care of the needs of other people. Well, we have people were living in their own flats. They may be in decent housing, but that doesn't mean that everyone is in the same situation. When I visited different districts, I often heard that, well, Mr. Leung, I've just been allocated a flat in a certain PRH estate, although it is an old unit, but that is better than winning Mark 6. So this represents the views of everyone in Hong Kong. Everyone in Hong Kong, regardless of their age and social sector, really wants decent housing. Mr. Wu Chi-wai. Thank you. Last August, CCP organized, announced a statement on people, cadres that should not be promoted when they have a problem. They will have problem of illegal structure. Well, EU said that once that matter was settled, you don't have any illegal structure problem. But for a UGL, well, DTZ is in fact a problem, and you did not declare interest back then. And of course, the Australian media also exposed your receipt of $50 million. You called it a golden handshake. It was paid to you by installments even after 2012, but you did not declare your asset to the Chief Justice as required, and you blatantly said that you didn't have a problem. Please come to your question. If you don't have a problem there, why have you wanted to edit the documents? Since he said that he is whiter than white and is very disciplined and perhaps he has been promoted even though he had some problematic practices. Now, you are being loathed by everyone in Hong Kong. So, see what I learned. You are so greedy. You are trying to hide your mistakes. Now, even though you are a state leader, that is not really an imperial sword. Even Lin Jihua suffered. So, are you worried that you might have to come clean with the Central Disciplinary Committee of the CP. Mr. Wu Jiwai is still trying to use this to accuse me. 2.5 years ago, I gave a clear account to the council. And once again, you have this subcommittee set up at the request of 20 members in this council. And now, the central government is clearly aware of what's happening in Hong Kong. Even those remarks made by Mr. Wu Jiwai, not for the first time, well, the central government is very knowledgeable of that. When that matter happened 2.5 years ago, I gave a clear account to the central authorities, so it's not that they are not aware of this. So 2.5 years down, Mr. Wu repeated such remarks other than politically motivated attack. I don't know what it is. So Mr. Wu talked about the declaration system of the SAR. All public officials, including those in the LegCo, have different declaration systems. Everyone should declare, should make declarations according to their respective systems. Mr. Wu Jiwai mentioned a number of examples. I've made declarations according to the declaration system. And the Secretariat of the ExCo in court recently explained under what circumstances where declarations were not required. Mr. Wu Jiwai, the question is whether you have given a clear account to the central authorities. So you have been using sophistry to tackle our questions. And so the question is whether you have been promoted to a state leader, although you have some misconduct. Because the central authorities might have chosen a state leader who might face a similar fate as Lin Jihua. The central authorities know very well. On the 1st of March, you and your pan-democratic members signed an open petition to the central authorities, and that what's in it was not really true. Mr. Pun Xiuping, any further supplement, Mr. Xi? I'm sure some other members will continue to pursue this line of questioning. Mr. Pun Xiuping, since January, in the past 6 months, there have been more than 12 cases of fatal accidents, industrial accidents, including those involving the Hong Kong-German car bridge. In the past 5 years, I've been asking you about whether a committee should be set up to improve protection for our industrial workers. So after 5 years, in page 159 of your policy agenda, you said that to gradually implement recommendations by the subcommittee to improve industrial or safety protection for workers. Late last month, finally, we received a paper from the Labor Department to the Manpower Panel. So it's just about enhancing publicity and administrative measures. Compensation and treatment are the greatest concerns of our workers. So I'd like to know what improvements are there in this consensus.
President, we are concerned about the issue of compensation, and we hope that we can come to a consensus in relation to the compensation and the level of compensation. Now, what we're more concerned about is the safety at work, the casualties that occur in the industrial accidents. The money cannot bring the life back, and money cannot restore the workers to their full health. So we have to do this on both counts, the compensation system, as well as the safety at work. These are dear to our hearts. Mr. Prince Xiuping, Mr. Chief Executive, when you ran for office, you said in your manifesto that the Commissioner for Labor will consider improving the safety at work, and there is a lack of a voice from the workers. Will this coordination panel incorporate the workers to tie in with your manifesto? But this can be considered. And with the representatives of the employers and the workers, many a time no consensus can be reached, and many a time they would dig their heels in and cannot reach any compromise. It's easy to set up a committee, and with a committee set up, we hope that we can achieve a consensus. And this is one of the difficulties that we face. Mr. Michael Look. Dr. Lau Silai, please sit down. President, thank you. Mr. Chief Executive, now, when you see this piggy bank, you know you can anticipate what I'm asking. I'm asking for the removal of the offsetting arrangement for the MPF. Now, the removal of this offsetting arrangement will be like smashing this piggy bank. And $30 billion have been leaked as a result of this offsetting arrangement. In your policy address, you followed up your election pledges and tried to remove the offsetting arrangement. But after consultation with the labor sector, we cannot accept the fact that the LSP and SP will be reduced in return for the removal of the offsetting arrangement. And you don't seem to be able to get the support of both the employer and the employee. You have a month or so in your term. Will you rise to the challenges and propose a model which will keep the LSP and the SP while scrapping the offsetting arrangement? Chief Executive, Mr. Leung Kuo Hong, if you carry on yelling in your seat, I will have to ask you to leave the chamber. Chief Executive, President, Mr. Michael Look's question is something of concern to me and my team. For a long time in the past, the administration has carried out in-depth discussion. We have looked at a lot of models. In my January policy address, I devoted a particular chapter to population policy and retirement policies. Before I put pen to paper, I've listened to the views of the employer and employee sectors. Mr. Michael Look and his colleagues came to the government headquarters and discussed that issue with the Secretary for Labor and Welfare and other officials. We did have a very in-depth discussion. We would try our very, very best. I know that we have 1 month or so left in the term. I cannot raise any unreasonable expectation that we're going to have a model which will be acceptable to both sectors. Mr. Michael Look is saying that towards the end of the term, we can come up with a model which is more acceptable to the labor sector. Now, it's easy to look at this, but we have to have regard to the views of both the employer and the employee. If no consensus is reached, even if we put forward this idea, we may not be able to take any step forward. We may not be able to have any fruitful results for us to resolve this intractable problem. And this is a problem that the previous administration never touched. Mr. Michael Look, now his reply is really hurting me very much. It is hurting the workers very much. Now, this scrapping off an offsetting arrangement is not a matter of consensus. It's a matter that you yourself consider important to resolve. So I have to put a question here again. In the remaining time, how soon are you going to come up with a model that would be acceptable to the labor sector? Mr. Chief Executive, some said that saying means achieving. As far as you are concerned, I hope that in your remaining time, you would leave a good legacy for the labor sector. Chief Executive, to answer this simply, in this month, the administration will take this matter forward. We're not going to be stuck at this stage. Mr. Jeremy Tam. Thank you, President. Simply put, Mr. Chief Executive, are you going to attend the Select Committee on UGL, Chief Executive? Well, it depends on the function of the Select Committee. If the Select Committee is just rehashing old things, it is a political show, then the answer would be very simple. Mr. Tam, well, as you can see, Mr. Leung is practicing a doublespeak as usual. Will you attend the Select Committee hearings? If you don't see the need, why did you bother asking Mr. Holden Chow to amend the scope of inquiry 40 areas? Now, you dare not face up to the issue and refuse to attend the hearing. What sort of answer is this? My question again, are you going to be attending the Select Committee hearings? Chief Executive. Chief Executive. Now, on the proposed scope of inquiry of the Select Committee, it is a proposed scope. I think it should be comprehensive. The work of the Select Committee should be brought to completion as soon as possible. That the scope is not sufficiently complete, so there are issues that have to be considered. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, under the ROP, the officials attending the meeting here cannot impute to members' motive. He is speculating motive, and this is very impolite. He mentioned rehashing old things. Now, this is a point of order. I think that you have to ask him to retract the words. Please sit down. Please be seated. Please sit down, Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, Chief Executive, and a supplement. chief executive, any supplement? I've got no supplement. Ms. Eunice Yong, President, according to the 2017 World Competitive Report, Hong Kong tops the world again, but economic performance, we've fallen out of the top 10 to 11th. Some economists said that other than external factors, Hong Kong's industrial structure reform is making no progress. I support the idea of increasing R&D so that we can nurture more talents, so we can make more contribution to economic development and the well-being of the public. Since 2005, you have three universities, Hong Kong UCUHK and HKUST, that have set up seven R&D centers in the mainland. Over the past 12 years, in terms of R&D achievements, what achievements have they made? And how will the administration help these centers to commercialize their R&D findings? And how are you going to assist the local industries to upgrade themselves and to boost Hong Kong's competitive edge and improve the economic performance? Chief Executive. Thanks very much, Ms. Yun Sung, for the question. This is an area that is worth exploring. This is a broad question. Let me address this as briefly as possible. The issue is important. If Hong Kong cannot grow its economy, the employers, the workers, the government will not have the financial wherewithal to improve livelihood and to build societies. Over the past 5 years, we've said that we have to improve the economy and improve livelihood. This is two sides of a coin. The economic development faces the problem of our industrial structure and also the competitiveness of some of the traditional industries. Finance is a big industry. We've seen good development over the past 5 years. It was 16% at the beginning of the term, and now it is 18% of the GDP. But for fintech, we are lagging behind. Compared with the mainland of China, we are falling behind. Ms. Yong raised all these questions. She mentioned R&D, that the administration attaches a great deal of importance to innovation and technology. So before we took office, we asked the previous administration back in 2012, put forward as part of the restructuring of the government secretariat, the establishment of an IT bureau. Now, members knew what transpired. This proposal was stalled through filibustering in LegCo, and it wasn't until 2 years or so ago that it was up and running. We have a lot of opportunities, but we have seen a lot of stalling, and this is one of the examples of stalling. Now, we have the IT Bureau. Over the past year or so, the response in the community has been really good. We have the good environment. Investors from locally and from outside are making investment. They're very interested in making investment in the IT sector. Ms. Yong mentioned the universities. We said before that we have to do a good job in innovation and technology, and there should be cooperation between the government, the business sector, the academe and the business sector. Now, we have to have the resources devoted to this. Now, these billions and billions of dollars are not new figures. It shows our determination. It shows our vision regarding the development of IT. For the industries, this is an important sector. If the industries can seize the trend coming out of the mainland of China and make profits, then I'm sure that our economic development will make a lot of difference. Now, for the academe, we have been liaising with the tertiary institutions. I've been working with six universities out of the eight and that have R&D. I've been liaising with the presidents. We have been discussing this issue, and I hope that the universities can do more and commercialize the R&D findings. Ms. Yong, I'm not sure you noticed about 2 months ago, the UGC suggested that the universities conduct some R&D with significant impacts, and the SAR government can be taking forward this government academic and industrial sectors in their development, and I'm sure that that there will be a good news that we can bring to members.
Mr. Lan Kuo-hung, I have warned you a number of times. Please do not play with your placard, and this is the last warning. If you force me to realize your dream last night, I will do so. Ms. Eunice Yeo, I think the EC has not specifically answered my question. I'm talking about fruits of R&D and also application. For instance, the R&D project by Hong Kong U has been incorporated into national plans. So I'd like to know how we can ensure such things can provide more openings for our young people. Yes, that's one example, whether it be bio, technology or physics or internet. Yes, a lot is happening. And we see how these products can be commercialized. And our vision is not just in Hong Kong. External investors may be interested in investing in R&D products of Hong Kong, and some of these products have been manufactured overseas. Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, thank you. Premier Lee Hak Kyung said in his March government work report that there should be intensified cooperation between Hong Kong and Zhuhai and Guangdong, and then there should be intensified planning for the Bay Area. BPA is of the view that the Bay Area plan will bring growth momentum, but we must be more proactive in communicating with the governments of Macau and also mainland cities. And at the government level, we should set up a committee chaired by the CE. And at the national level, there should also be a coordinating mechanism so that we can formulate policies to promote the flow of capital, people, and information among the three places. Otherwise, we risk falling behind, and then we'll lose our competitive edge. According to media reports, the National Reform and Development Commission will have specific plans on the development of the Great Bay Area by the end of this year. I'd like to know the details of work of our government. Can you elaborate on the follow-up work and the timetable and how we can ensure that there can be a smooth transition to the next government in this regard? Mr. Ma Fong Kwok, my word has been blocked by a number of display items in front of me. My view is blocked. Mr. CE, thank you, Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, for your question. And I thank Mr. Wai Kwok and his BPA members for giving me a very detailed, specific proposal last week. And of course, I've read the proposal myself, and I have circulated to relevant officials within the government. The Bay Area City Cluster plan is, of course, very important to the SAR, not just to the coming 10 years. I'm talking about the future of our younger generation. They're going to benefit tremendously in the coming 3-4 decades in their career life. In my office, just 5 years ago, I stuck up a very big satellite plan of the PRD. I can see Hong Kong, Shenzhen, the eastern and western banks of the PRD with a big catchment area. The reason why I have posted that map on the wall of my office in the past 5 years is to serve as a reminder, the geographical conditions surrounding Hong Kong, this is an important factor. Different government colleagues would come to meet at my office when we talked about environmental, population, and infrastructure issues. We have to know the geography of Hong Kong. There are 11 cities in the Bay Area, covering Hong Kong, Macau, and 9 cities in the mainland. They are very complementary, and there is a lot of room for cooperation. I led a delegation of about 30, with also friends from the media, on a 3-day, 2-night visit to the Bay Area, and we were very impressed. What follows? Mr. Low mentioned 2 aspects, whether a subcommittee will be set up, and second, at the timetable, whether we can come up with a specific plan by the end of this year. First, on the question of a timetable, in the past 2 to 3 months, although this term is drawing to an end, myself and my colleagues have been very busy. I really am very grateful to my colleagues. Once again, I want to thank them. We have not certainly got the mentality of being towards the end of our term. We have not slowed down our pace. One of the reasons why I've been so busy is to carry out the preparatory work for the Bay Area development. So in our visit to Bay Area cities, 2 committee members and also there are also members of the EXCO committee. We have CSD and the Economic Development Commission and the EXCO. After the visit, we had a joint conference of CSD and EDC to discuss the visit. Because time is a bit tight, even if we set up a specific committee, we may not be able to come to any thing within such a short period of time. So we use the Strategic Development Commission as well as the Economic Development Committee to discuss things. Our timetable is very tight. The country as well as our mainland cities work very expeditiously, and our system is different from theirs. We cannot afford to fall behind. If we do so, then the Bay Area plan will be confirmed without full participation on our part. And this is something we don't want to see. The Reform and Development Commission has taken the lead, and the Guangdong province is also involved, and 9 cities, Macau, and also the Hong Kong SAR are involved. So this is a 4-party organization. Before the end of this term, we hope we can have a framework and document mapping out the way forward so that under the leadership of the Reform and Development Commission and also the nine cities and the two SARs, we can come up with a framework document to let different sectors understand the direction of the Bay Area plan. And then the next administration can lose no time in deepening its work under the framework. Of course, for important issues involving this administration, we will certainly discuss with the next administration, including the CE designate. Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, BPA's proposal covering the Bay Area has got 12 big areas of proposals: tax arrangements, infrastructure, connectivity, and waiving of roaming charges, and also lowering the entry. I think they can ask multi-barrel questions. They are wasting time. I'm waiting to ask him questions. Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, please come to your question as soon as possible. For many Hong Kongers working in the PRD, no matter what trade they are in, care a lot about the tax arrangements, whether there can be special arrangement, whether the 183-day rule can be waived. What is your view on this, CE? The Great Bay Area is something we should really explore. LegCo is an important part of our constitutional setup, and the Great Bay Area is an important issue which LegCo should take part in. I thank Mr. Wai Kwok for this new question. Together with the RDC and the province and the cities, we are discussing. Now, to summarize it, our discussion, the idea is how we can comply with one country, two systems, and within that framework, we rule out or remove obstacles due to differences in systems so that Hong Kong and the cities within the Great Bay Area can have flow of capital, people, information, so there can be better flow of production and living factors. The important production factors. Now, if there is better interflow between these places, then this is a win-win situation. For flow of people, the story raised a tax issue. Indeed, this is an important issue. We have R&D talents. Well, the whole research team is, and also the infrastructure is in the mainland, but because they're over 183 days, then they have to pay tax. Mr. Lang Kwok Hong, leave the chamber at once. Lang Kwok Hong, Mr. Lang Kwok Hong, leave the chamber at once. Mr. CE, within one country, and there are two systems, so there are different tax rates. The flow of people and experts in particular have encountered obstacles. This is something we have to face up to. We're still discussing with the central authorities and also the province a way out acceptable to different parties to promote interchange of talents so that Hong Kong and the nine cities and province in the mainland and the country can benefit. So this is our way forward. We have some ideas. In between, I hope there can be more specific proposals from you. And Mr. Lo Wai Kok referred to the 12-point proposal from BPA. We'll certainly consider it.
Dr. Lee, point of order. President, you allowed three members to spend 9 minutes, 11 minutes, 7 minutes for the three respective members. I think you have to distribute the time. If members are too long-winded, you have to stop them. Well, I've said that members should put simple questions. I cannot control the way the chief executive answers the questions, although I appeal to him to be brief. Professor Joseph Lee, I don't know how long I have. During the Dragon Boat Festival, I can't hear you. Perhaps you might want to wear an earpiece. My time is ticking on. On Dragon Boat Festival, I bumped into the 5-year-old kid that you mentioned. Well, my mic is very loud. It doesn't matter. I just carry on anyway. It's in the handset. I'm spending my time. Maybe someone would shout a point of order. On Dragon Boat Festival, I bumped into the 5-year-old kid that you mentioned. Time flies. He's in primary two. He told me that he's worried. He's got a neighbor who is a nurse in mental health, a head nurse. He said that your friend is all smiles, and he is going back to many people's Facebook pages, and he's always all smiles, and he doesn't answer all the questions. And for some reason, overtly and covertly, he's acting in collusion. He's interfering with the what something L incident. That kid was very concerned, and someone said to the kid, "This man is suffering from all symptoms of mental illness." Now, this head nurse would like to help, but he said that in the community, he has to look after 60 to 80 ex-mental patients, and the new cases would take 1 or 2 years to be treated. And the kid said, "I don't know. This is happening to my friend." Now, this kid asked me to ask you, Mr. Chief Executive, before you leave office, will there be more resources being devoted so that one nurse can look after 30 mental patients, and the new case can be shortened in the waiting time? And this head nurse will be able to take this man to mental treatment. So will you be writing this down and hand this over to the next administration and address this particular problem? This kid is very concerned whether his friend is suffering from mental illness. Chief Executive, President, we spend a lot on healthcare and welfare. I mentioned in my introductory remarks all these figures. If there is actual needs, Professor Joseph Lee, as a representative of your functional constituency, you might wish to put forward specific proposals. When funding is being proposed, now we have to go through LegCo for the funding approval. It's not simply a question of mental health. There are many other issues of concern to the members of the public. I hope that Professor Li will take the lead and resolve these stalling tactics and these filibustering practices. Not just mental health, there are many livelihood issues, infrastructure projects that are waiting funding approval. Once we've got these out of the way, we would have time for issues of concern to members. In answer to the questions raised by other members, housing, 70% of the people are concerned. The IT sector is very concerned. GBA, Greater Bay Area, we didn't have a very detailed discussion in electrical retirement. The public are very concerned. In the Q&A session, are these issues warrant more time for the chief executive to address? I'm sure that the people of Hong Kong would be exercising their own judgment. Professor Li, well, the chief executive has spent a couple of minutes answering the question, but the five-year-old friend raised a specific question. Will more resources be devoted to the mental health so that one nurse will handle 20, 30 cases instead of more, and there would be shortening the time for new cases? I've been here for a decade. We've been talking about this, and the case is the situation is worsening, and the caseload is getting larger. Now you have about 4 weeks. It doesn't matter even if you can't do it. You just write it down for the new administration for them to follow up. Now this kid will be putting the question to me again, Chief Executive. I'm sure Professor Li's proposal is genuine, and I hope that he and the PANDAM members will not stall matters when it comes to funding proposal, and they should endorse the funding as soon as possible. Mr. Raymond Chen, President, 2 years ago, CY Leung appointed Holden Chow to the EOC. 2 years later, what did Holden Chow do? We don't know all the full details, but in the Select Committee on UGL, Holden Chow did something for CY Leung. It doesn't bear repeating. Now, 2 years later, CY Leung appointed Holden Chow to the EOC again. As we all know, Holden Chow objects to all the same-sex marriage ordinance. He is against the discriminatory ordinance. Even Mr. Chen, chairman of EOC, thought that there are problems because Holden Chow's position is flying in the face of the EOC position. His appointment of Holden Chow to the EOC would be like appointing someone who's eating game animals and wearing a mink to a committee protecting wild animals. Why do you make such an appointment? Why do you make the appointment again? If DAB members have to be appointed, Edward Lau, Elizabeth Court, and Gary Chen can be better choices. I think this is a collusion. This is a reward for what Holden Chow did for CY Leung. Or you are not really minded to promote equality. You're trying to get someone to get in the way. Are you going to retract Holden Chow's appointment, Chief Executive? Now, this is a necessary speculation. If you speculate like this, the PANDAM members sitting over on this side, they have been getting in the way of the administration. They've been objecting to me. Is it because that I didn't appoint them? That's why they objected to my initiatives. I don't think this is a good grounded speculation. Mr. Chen, CY Leung never answered why he's appointing someone who's against the equal opportunity, who's against the sexual minority to this committee. In the UK, the US and France, they have endorsed same-sex union. Taiwan is following suit. Now you said that we're filibustering. I think CY Leung is filibustering on equal opportunity. You have achieved no progress. Now, paragraph 131 of your first policy address, that this is a controversial issue, you're not doing it. What issues are not controversial? I'm not going to do anything at all, Chief Executive. Myself and my administration make appointment to different committees, including electoral members once, and they're appointed, they become members of these committees. The SAR government, just because they have any particular views or any position regarding certain issues, doesn't mean that we would stop appointing them. Dr. Martin Liao, President, this year marks the 20th anniversary of Hong Kong's return to the mainland. How will the Chief Executive assess the implementation of one country, two systems, and the basic law, and what are the most pressing issues facing Hong Kong? Chief Executive. President, thanks very much to Dr. Martin Liao's question. Hong Kong's return to the mainland and the establishment of the SAR, Hong Kong practice one country, two systems, Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong. This has been a success. To take stock of the past 20 years in implementing the basic law and all the issues, big and small, and also to take stock of our achievement and also to peer into the next 20 years and what we have to make preparation. Now, there is one point which is very clear, and that is that we have to understand look at the basic law. Chief Executive, please. Hong Kong as a special administrative region of the nation. The basic law is implemented on the 1st of July 1997. We cannot vaguely talk about one country, two systems. Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong, high degree of autonomy, and this is not enough. Because since 1990, we have the basic law promulgated on the 1st of July 1997. Hong Kong basic law has been implemented. I think we have to look at the provisions. There are some views that when the central authorities espouse certain positions, when we take certain initiatives, it is regarded as undermining one country, two systems. If we have any views, we have to go back to the basic law and all the provisions. The power of the central authorities is clearly spelled out in the basic law. So it's not vaguely an issue of other than national defense and foreign affairs. The mainland will not look at anything else. Now, it's not simply a question of the horse racing will go on and dancing will go on. Just because they didn't mention that people can engage in stock trading doesn't mean that people cannot engage in stock trading. So I think we have to look at why the provisions are there in the basic law, the original intent. I think to answer the question simply, it is terribly important to have education on the basic law. It's not it's not education in school, it's education of the basic law in the community. Now, 2 years ago when we talked about the constitutional reform, civic nomination wasn't there in the basic law. Those young people who took part in the Occupy movement were not aware of that, so I think it is terribly important to have education on the basic law in the community. Dr. Martin Liao, the Chief Executive is leaving office. Will he share with us his gains and loss over the years. Over the past 5 years, close to 1st of July, we would give a work report on the past year. This year, we're going to have a report for the past 5 years, and you can have a look at this report and give your input in an objective manner. Now, for this five-year report, as opposed to the manifesto when I ran for office, are there any areas that we have in the manifesto that remain undelivered, or are there any things that are not in the manifesto that we have achieved? Dr. Lau Xiaolai, please leave the chamber.
Mr. CE, as I was saying, we have a plan for the past 5 years of administration. I'm sure it will be meaningful to the whole community how administration has what administration can done in the past 5 years amidst of challenges. I'm very grateful to my team. Ms. Soi Chi-Fong, any point of order? According to ROP8, the CE attends meetings of the council to be questioned by legislators on his work. When it comes to his feelings, is it a question? Yes, it is a specific question. Please be seated. Mr. CE, I'm done. Mr. Kenneth Leung, thank you, President. Mr. Siwai Leung, finally, I've got this opportunity to engage in a direct dialogue with you. Recently, I understand that you have a lot of understanding about tax issues. Unfortunately, I didn't have time to read your blogs and Facebook, but there is a specific tax issue I have to ask you. Two weeks ago, I was the chairman of the Inner Revenue Number 2 Amendment Bill, and then suddenly there's CSA from the administration. The bill was about aircraft leasing. And then, according to the government, OECD asked that Hong Kong amends its own Inner Revenue Ordinance. This is a big issue because under the basic law, we have autonomy over legislative matters in many issues about taxation and finances in particular. We're subject to the directions of many international organizations. As the CE, how can you tackle these issues? Because these international organizations were formed by administrators without any mandate from anyone, whereas we are subject to the instructions by these international organizations. How do you address this issue? CE, Hong Kong is part of the international community. We are highly open and internationalized community. We attach significance to the views of international organizations on many matters of SAR, including taxation matters. When they have formed a view on Hong Kong, is that to Hong Kong's detriment or benefit? As the government, we have to take care of the overall and long-term interests of Hong Kong. So this is not about instructions or directions from these organizations. If Mr. Kenneth Leung is concerned about instructions from overseas governments to our government, I have more examples for Mr. Leung to query in the future. Mr. Kenneth Le, does he has an answer to my question. The legislative contents may not necessarily be applicable to Hong Kong. So, Mr. Leung, can you be more serious in addressing these issues? Because I would say in enacting legislation, it's very important we have to maintain a bottom line as to what these recommendations from overseas organizations are acceptable and what not. We have to express our position very clearly. I'm very grateful to have your support of the government. In Hong Kong, when we have tax initiatives, we can't be counterproactive. We cannot cause overseas communities to have negative impression on us, leading to sanctions in the future. Mr. Chen Hanpeng, I think it is most cost-effective that we have a co-location of clearance in Hong Kong, and I am grateful to the hard work made by the government. However, people like to have conspiracy theories. Even before the plan is unveiled, they like to say that it is against one country, two systems, and violating the basic law. So can you please clarify, in your discussions with the mining authorities on the co-location arrangement, what are the principles, what are the benefits to Hong Kong, and when would the plan be announced? CE, the overriding principle is, of course, to be in line with the basic law. This is the overarching principle. We hope that Hong Kong can have the co-location arrangement within the confines of the basic law, because when XRL has got co-location arrangement, then the social and economic benefits will multiply. Now, if you have ridden on express rails in the mainland, you know that our country is among the best in the world in terms of construction and also connection of express rails. So this is an important issue. Without co-location arrangement, then we can only reach cities with crossing points in the mainland, and the number is limited. We have to maximize the social and economic benefits of the XRL. Co-location arrangements are common in other parts of the world. Two different countries have different sovereignties. We know sovereignty of a country is of utmost importance and jealously guarded by their government and people. However, that's happening in other countries. Nobody has said that the two governments with co-location arrangements have betrayed sovereignty of their own country. Nobody has ever said so. We can all see the need and also the efficiency brought about by this arrangement. Now, for the West Kowloon XRL, this is not the first time we have co-location arrangement in Shekou. Shenzhen Bay, we also have co-location arrangement of clearance facilities. So we have to complete the study in the jurisprudence. We hope to come to a conclusion soon. Mr. Chen Hanpeng, even between countries, there can be co-location arrangements, not to mention that Hong Kong is part of China. And such a plan should be implemented even easier. We are getting closer and closer to the commissioning of the XRL, and legislative time is limited. I'd like to know when the government will launch its plan on co-location arrangements. We will do so as soon as possible. Relevant departments. Well, this is another reason why we've been so busy in the past few months, although we are drawing close to the end of this term. Colleagues within the government have been very busy, and we will work very quickly. When we come to a conclusion, we will announce to the council and the community ASAP. Mr. Lam Chak Ting, President, just now CY Leung said that when people mentioned a UGL, it was just a politically motivated, and he has already come clean on this matter. However, many people have the view that your account was far from clear and true. Many people, including myself, suspect you of corruption and conflict of interest in this matter. I give you one more chance. This is your last Q&A session with this council. Please tell your justifications. I'll quote the main content of the UGL agreement. First, to support UGL's acquisition of DZZ, so that senior management of DTZ can continue to serve and there is a no poach, no competition agreement. And secondly, when there is a reasonable request from UGL to help UGL and DTZ from time to time and to serve and not confined to playing the role of an advisor and a referee, and without causing any conflict of interest, such assistance should be rendered. The handwritten words are scribbled by yourself. It is learned that. And according to the EXCO's Declaration of Interest System, B, you have to register your interest, including paid work and profession. My question to CY Leung is, since you're receiving millions of dollars in reward, and one of the terms is from time to time promote a private enterprise, why is not regarded as paid work or consultancy service? Because you're required to serve as an advisor or referee. My question to CY Leung is, in the advisor agreement, is it true that so long we have this phrase to provide service without any conflict of interest, then all public officers, including members of the EXCO, they have the same system as you do, so that can they sign a secret advisory service agreement with the handwritten words you filled in? There is no conflict of interest, and since there is no conflict of interest, no declaration is required. If this is true, how can we defend our integrity system in Hong Kong? I am very confident in our integrity system in Hong Kong. Mr. Lam Chak Ting, once again, took things out of context in his questions. I implore Mr. Lam Chak Ting to understand this matter with common sense. UGL is an Australian listed company. DTZ is a UK listed company. Someone has reported to both the enforcement agencies of Australia and the UK. The exit agreement has been made known for 2.5 years. Overseas law enforcement agencies have said that they're not going to investigate. Now, if you have no confidence in our integrity system, you should have confidence in their counterparts in Australia and the UK. And people have written to the tax jurisdictions of these two countries repeatedly. If you have no confidence in our own IRD, you should have confidence in their counterparts in these two countries. The exit agreement was drafted by a lawyer, and you could see the legal terms, and there was signed by a witness. Now, DTZ and UGL are listed companies. They have the internal checks and balances. Well, we've been rehashing this so many for so long, but no one has ever approached me. Never has there been any complaint. We must have an objective and full understanding of this matter. Mr. Lam Chak Ting, first, I have not quoted out of context. I have quoted the main content of the agreement. You can point out, where is my quotation wrong? Refer to overseas law enforcement agencies. What about investigation by our own ICAC? Using your own logic, does that mean that you are problematic? Well, you said that since it was drafted by a lawyer, it's okay. The lawyer didn't know beforehand that you would be the CE. This is not a debate. Please come to your question. My question is very simple. All members of EXCO, can they follow your footstep? Can they sign an agreement before becoming EXCO members to provide advisor service to large companies and tycoons in Hong Kong? Is it perfectly okay if they have not provided any service while they're EXCO members? Is there no corruption? Can they serve as EXCO members and continue to receive millions of dollars in reward?
But so you say.
But President, there is no need for these to be declared under our system. We made it very clear. Stop fooling people. The CE's Q&A session ends here. The CE will now leave the chamber. Members, please stand up. Mr. Xu Ka-chun, please stop shouting. Mr. Xu Ka-chun, you have to leave the chamber. This council will resume at 11:30 a.m. to continue to deal with the remaining business on the agenda of yesterday's council meeting. I now adjourn the council.